Behind bars, in 229 prisons across the country, there are currently some 126,000 prisoners. Its floodlights illuminating the night sky, set against a backdrop of green hills, consequently dubbed Sun City, Johannesburg Prison is no pleasure resort. Originally intended as a temporary transmission center, today an overcrowded and run-down Sun City accommodates roughly 7,000 prisoners. Of these, some 4,000 are awaiting trial. As another day begins and hundreds prepare for court, thousands continue waiting.
Some of them have been waiting for up to 2 years, those who are mostly to appear before the Supreme Courts and the higher courts. And we have plus minus about 4,000 of them. I'll say it's probably from about 170 to about 200%. Because the minimum that we could hold, we hold about twice that amount of prisoners in most cells. And it is a problem in terms of controlling and direct supervision of prisoners and having to identify your problem prisoners from your sort of normal prisoners and separating them from the people who are here for the first or for the second time. Robbery, murder, robbery of aggravating circumstances. The people who are inside here are desperate people. They spend all their time thinking about how they can go out, especially if a person knows his fate is facing multiple charges which can send him to a maximum prison for a very long, long time. So if they get a chance, they fear nothing. If they see there's a way to go out and you are the obstacle, then they'll take you out of the way.
More? More. Complaints, Kalu? All right, who's going to court today? Hof. Kitchen. Zonke van de Madala stokjes.
Prisoners disappear from prison. Computer frauds. Prisoners having to pay for certain services. Is corruption amongst our members. I think we are not aware at this stage of the actual content of corruption. We are only aware of what has surfaced until now. You see, when this type of thing happens, there is mistrust amongst members. You do not know which member could be trusted. And unfortunately, the money buys anything.
They are supposed to treat us all as the human beings, not to divide us, because now they are dividing us. If you are not having money, you cannot go to hospital. In the gate there, they will ask you an escort. If you don't have an escort, you must pay to the water. Five rand. It's Sun City, that is Sun City. It's corruption. Because now, if I don't have five rand, I must not go to hospital. I must die in my cell.
Gentlemen, you take only one ride. Right.
But I've got a problem, really, because the system here in prison is the one that has caused me to stay here longer. I was supposed to go to court on the 5th. And on that day, when I went down, because we are locked up here, so we can't go there early, I found my truck to Hillbrook gone. But then the following day, I was called again to court, and there was a mistake down here in the reception. And then I was taken to Westgate Court instead of Hillbrook. So consequently, I never went to my court. And then I never even saw the magistrate, but I was still remanded. It's like I'm being remanded for nothing just because of the incompetence of the jail system.
Fingerprinted, counted, and loaded into police vans, every day hundreds of awaiting trial prisoners are dispatched to the various courts. Because they have not been sentenced, awaiting trial prisoners cannot get into rehabilitation or skills training programs. As the vans set off, the thousands of awaiting trial prisoners that remain prepare for yet another empty day.
Mostly they are just spending their day in the cells, and then they eat, and then they have their allocated exercise, and then they go back to the cells again until the next routine of food giving and medication.
This is a waste of life. It's overpopulated, yeah? The food is horrible. Everything is horrible. You're getting so stressed, depressed. They somehow hang themselves, yeah. I've got how many marks, cut marks, that I wanted to kill myself already because of my whole life is going for a waste.
Well, at this stage, these people are only kept here. They are bored, they are idle, and nothing is done. We do not have the infrastructure, we do not have the facilities, and these who are not fortunate to be transferred, and they will be released eventually, perhaps worse than what they were when they were admitted.
I laid out 21 months, no bail. Huh? Now it's a year again. I want to work, I want to do something with my life, man. Don't want to lay here like a fraud ding, hanging around, roofing the people, to survive. I must go roof the people, what must I do? Huh? The new ones that comes in, I clap him, I take their hooters, I go sell them, I smoke dacha, what must I do? He has nothing to do, not even games to jol, nothing, nothing. Huh? And if you don't look after yourself, who's going to look after you? Nobody's looking after you.
We really should be doing something other than just sitting like this. If there could be some things like maybe recreational centers, or maybe sports or some gymnasium or anything that could keep us busy. We just sit, play cards, go to park in the kitchen, come back, lay on our beds. Then at 3 we were just closed up until morning the following day.
If you go to the Besuk, you will find sometimes the whole week the speakers are not working. How are you going to communicate with your people? Whereas they are coming from outside to come and talk with you. You're going to shout, shout, shout. You look like a mad person. As from last week, I was running up and down to look for the legal advices. Till now, I'm still waiting because I need my case to be discussed.
I would say it stresses out the prisoners and the others because the visit is the only contact a prisoner has with his family, with his people outside. And that is jealously guarded. And at the awaiting trial prisoner, they get opportunity to see their people about twice a week.
The accommodation for this cell is 18, and the unlock this morning is 46. Okay, I think what's also very important to realize is that with the overcrowding we have here, because of staff shortages, these guys have to spend 23 hours out of 24 locked up in the cell. They get open for 1 hour exercise, and that unfortunately doesn't happen every day. Because of staff shortages, weather conditions, etc., they sometimes have to spend 24 hours out of 24 in these cells. We have no workshops. We have 2 social workers for 3,500 prisoners, 1 psychologist, no classrooms, no recreational programs. This is an admission center where they're supposed to be sentenced and transferred elsewhere, but because of overcrowding elsewhere, we're unable to get them out as quick as we'd like. It causes frustration amongst the prisoners, but it also causes frustration for the staff members who have to work in these conditions.
Is definitief die doodsteek. Programme en projekte kan nie realiseer nie. So dan is ook die hoofrol hierso. Want die gevangene word nou toegesluit, HIV besmette gevangene, so dan seer hom. Daar is ook 'n spesifieke plek waar ons hulle kan afsonder. Die man is gevonnis, met gevolg, hy moet maar slaap, waar een slaapplek is. Dit bou frustrasie tussen gevangenes, lede werk nou in die kritiese toestand.
Where is this budget? We have sports. Where is it? There's nothing here in this jail. We lay here 23 hours, 24 hours a day.
Huh? No exercise.
No exercise some days here. Huh? What is it? Why can't they leave some of this prison that we must sleep? There's only 30 beds here, but we are 46 people in this cell.
Kijk, as ons as gevangenes wat inkom in die sentrum om te rehabiliteer. Maar hier, ons kom maar nie om te rehabiliteer op rede van wat hier leer zijn. Om meer skills, die is amper so warehouse waar criminals bij mekaar kom. Hier is moordenaars, hier is rapers, hier is ijsbrekers, hier is rovers. Ek wat 6 maanden kom doen voor paroolbrief, moet nou tussen hulle kom. En daar veroorzaak ek corruptie. Want hy gaat nou vir my meer inlig in verband met crime.
Het ek Michelle aan die brand gestuur. Ek het die kopieëse by die krul gesit, matras by die krul gesit, en die lakens en kleren gehang binnen my sel, en ek het die sel aan die brand gesteek. Wel, soos ek wat dag lyk, kan hulle sel sien, soos hulle my naam noem, ek het Takkie. Maar die dokter, hy weier om vir my te help. Hy in my gezicht gesê, voor die ander medische ordinante, hy sal my nie helpie, en hy sal ook hierdie staatse geld mos op my, soos meneer kan sien. My handen, my vingers het ek verloor in die gevangenis, die probleme wat ek geheet het, wat ek kan opgelos word hier. Daarom het ek vir hom gesê, ek gaat Michelle aan die brand steek om hulle aandacht te kry, dat hulle my kan neem naar die officiere wat hoorder as hy is. Maar hy gaan weier nog steeds om my te jaag.
Boos is op die oomblik 23 in die kamer, maar hy kan net 10 in. Hy kan net 10 in die kamer slaap. Sien meneer, meneer kan slaap, sien klein kamer. Die kamer is heeltemal baie klein voor ons, meneer. Kijk hoe slaap ons, meneer. Ek weet as dat drukke word nie. Ons het die ruimte om te kan loop en allerlei dinge nie. Meneer, ek leer niks nie wat ek aan die kamer laat. Kom, slaap. Ons moet een klomp bendes in die kamer. Ek kan nie sê ek het iets geleer as het nou terwijl ek aan die kamer laat. Kom, ons moet een klomp bendes hier. Nou, Rian, toe kom hier over sie van die tronks om me. Sien, meneer, toe loeren ze me hier door die spiegel. Meneer, die hoofd van die gevangenis. Hij vloek zomaar die bandieten. Maar die bandiet loer me net bies in die gang. Hij kom, hij is die hoofd. Van die hele gevangene, hy sê so my, jou maas, poes, al die dinge.
Jy kan sien ek is guy, ek en my vriendin is soos hier staan. Like myself, I didn't have a rough time here. Yeah? And I don't think I'll ever have a rough time. Because all the people around here is very, they're very nice to us. That's all. Yeah, I'm safe. I think I'm safe. Yes. I dress like a woman, I move around like a woman, but where sleeping around is concerned, nothing like that. I committed a crime, murder, and yeah, just murder.
In all our prisons we have the various gangs, and of course if they've got nothing else to do than to sit around all day locked up in a cell, the gang activities will be worse than elsewhere.
Die 26, die 27 en die 28. Ek is 'n 26 bende. 'N Frans, hy kom in die gevangenis, hy sit sy hart by 'n bende, hoekom? Hy wil nie môre oomôre, vir hom word gesê hy moet klere was, hy moet dit doen, hy moet dit doen, hy kan nie gehaal het by hom nie. Want hy is nou 'n Frans, hy sien 'n bende nie. Nou, hy sit sy gedagte daar, hy wil eendag graag 'n bende raak. Hoekom? Hy wil ook sy gehaal in sy voetes kontrol. En hier 'n bende te raak, is hy om te rehabiliteer. Sy raak 'n bende, sy gaan uit. Sy gaan oefen die bendeskap uit. Hier en deur hy bendeskap, dan kom sy weer terug in die gevangenis.
I'm a 27, meneer. Meneer, om 'n 27 te is, meneer. Ek stiek op 'n ambte, meneer, mis. Sien, meneer. Ook is sommer nie, meneer, man. Ook is sommer nie.
Alright, we're now in the B2 section where we keep the maximum prisoners, those sentenced to maximum sentences. The unlock this morning is 264, 8 staff members on duty.
As gevolg van nie genoegsame lede, het gebeur het baie kere, soos ek net al gesê het, daar is 8 lede op die spesifieke afdeling, en die lede is die hele dag op die betrokke afdeling. Van die lede gaat gevangenis wegvat vir sielkundige behandeling, dokter, maatskap, dan bly het totaal van 360 gevangenis, en die 2 lede is verantwoordelik, en dit is maksimum kategorie gevangenis. So hulle lewe is ook in gevaar, die oomblik, sodra hulle 2 agterby. En dis waar ons kom by die stresgevalle. Die ou kan dit nie hanteer nie. Hy dink dat môre is ek alweer alleen. Môre moet ek alweer alleen kos gee. Wat doen ek dan? Ons kry baie kere waar lede aangerand word. Lede wat gesteek word. Of lede wat gedreig word. Ons het byvoorbeeld die HIV gevalle. Waar hulle die lede gedreig het dat die lede noodwendig moes afsiek gaan. Hulle het spuitnaalde gehad. En hoe kan jy in so'n situasie funksioneer? Jou daaglikse taak. Die manne het vrouwen en kinders buite. En hy moet in die omstandighede kom werk. Hier is hier plan, hier het ons bomaanvallen gehad, het ons aangenaad wat afgegaan het, vuurwapen, wat binnen die inrichting geskiet is, wat sal veiligheidsvoorwaarde word daar gestel in hierdie omstandighede.
We are aware of that, and I can tell you, you know, we commend our members because they work under terrible circumstances. But, you know, if you know the situation, knowing that the government, they can't get money, we keep hardened criminals. We work under terrible circumstances. And maybe that as a means can show the government that they need to give attention to prison system.
First time around in a prison, I got the fight of my life. You walk into a communion cell, you don't know what to expect. You've heard stories about prison. You're actually expecting the worst. They sodomize people. I mean, it happens, especially with youngsters. And if you can't fend for yourself, they'll force you into it. A lot of assaults do still occur. The warders work together. Obviously, they try and fend for each other. It's difficult. They tend to use more than the necessary violence anyway. I see it every day. And if you haven't got help from the outside, most probably it'll happen again. It's possible that you can learn a lot of stuff inside, yeah. In Afrikaans, they say it's a misdaad opleiding centrum. I guess it's the truth. Living conditions, I expect them to be clean. The food should be clean. To be able to sleep between clean sheets in the night and on a bed, and no lice infected blankets or mattresses. And just to be seen as a normal human being who's made a mistake, and to be given a chance to prove yourself again and go back into society. I'm serving a sentence of 12 years at the moment, of which I've already finished just about on 6 years. It happened in 1991. I shot a man at Jan Smuts Airport. In this prison, we see it from our side, there's a lot of smuggling going around. For instance, in a coffee tin, they'll smuggle at Dachau. And certain members will let it through for a 10 rand. You will turn and look the other way. I mean, drugs are freely available. I can buy a bottle of brandy, I can go now and can buy one for 50 rand. If I want to go through a gate sometimes, there's certain members that you have to pay money to go through, for instance.
The prisoners who like buying the prison water, maybe he wants to move from this section to the other section and say, no, man, I'll give you 2 rand, I just want to go to that section. Or there are guys maybe coming from the other section, they want to get the small guys, say, hey, look here, I'll give you this. Just give me this small guy. You must go and stay with us.
Firstly, we're establishing a corruption unit. I'm going to Israel to see their undercover system and to get help from them. They'll train our orders. And we'll use prisoners, we'll use private people for undercover system to hit at corruption altogether. And we'll fight it tooth and nail.
To rehabilitate yourself inside, you're going to have to depend on yourself. To stay motivated inside here is difficult. I do believe, of course, that sport is one of the main programs as such for rehabilitation. They do have drug rehabilitation groups. Then again, there aren't enough social workers. I mean, there's one working here. Churches especially. We don't have enough churches inside here. At the moment, I'm doing a course through Vista College to be a faithful witness for God. There are many lost souls inside here, and me being here for so long, I do believe that I can commit myself to show others that it is possible to rehabilitate yourself inside here. It's a mistake I've made. You can't wish it away. It's a part of my life that I wouldn't like to have over. Although one day I can sit down and look back at this, and I believe and I know that I've come out of here a better person.
The role of prison is to correct the behavior of an individual, to rehabilitate the individual from what he has been to somebody who would contribute positively to the community as well as his or her own family. Realistically, majority of them cannot be rehabilitated. The shortage of social workers as well as medical staff. We as psychologists at Johannesburg Prison are only 2 and the population of plus minus 7,000 prisoners. So we focus on the real needy prisoners, those who are depressed or who are suicidal. And we have more or less 2,000 of rape offenders in the prison at the moment. And as far as the psychology department is concerned, it cannot cope with the rape offenders, but the very few that we feel they benefit out of our rape programs, we do focus upon. The state is spending money on the custody of the offender, not much on the rehabilitation of the offender.
It's a very simple sentence. She is no longer going to Europe.
The guys are very, very interesting as far as education is concerned. Because most of them, they can't even write their names. They can't construct a sentence. So we have to start afresh from the basics then. Almost everyone who is already assessed is willing to come to classes on a daily basis so that when they go outside, then they have learned a lot from the prison.
And then Oscar is from Johannesburg. They meet, let's say they meet in Sun City.
After so far, we are 3 educationists in our section, and then we have to go through plus or minus 240 prisoners. We have decided to take them in tens.
With structured education and training programs restricted to only 57 of the 229 prisons, for the majority of prisoners, rehabilitation is far from guaranteed. Sergeant Obed Joyi is one of a number of committed members, voluntary educationists who, in spite of conditions, are doing what they can to facilitate non-formal supportive education and training programs in an effort to enhance the qualifications and skills of prisoners towards successful reintegration on release.
Committed murder and robbery outside. I was a compulsive drug addict at the time. I was just 19 years old. And I feel that they haven't given us enough opportunities as prisoners, especially me as a youngster. I've got potential. I'm not lazy. I do want to work. I want the opportunity to develop my skills in a specific trade as plumbing, you see. But up until this far, I haven't been given that opportunity. They don't even want to send me away so that I can go maybe Krugersdorp or Leeuwkop, where there is that facilities for me to upgrade my skill. So that when I go outside, I know I got something to fall back on. I bumped my head. I stood the responsibility for what I did. I even pleaded guilty in court because I realized then it was a wrong thing, a sin that I did at the time. So, but now I haven't been given that opportunity, you see. So I've been here for 5 years. It's wasted 5 years. I got nothing and I'm scared of going outside because I know outside is difficult. When I was sentenced, the court stated that I will be getting my rehabilitation. Today I demanded rehabilitation from the court because I haven't received it yet.
I know of prisons in this area, prisons where I've been previously, where they've got the facilities, where prisoners are trained, where the overpopulation is not so bad as what it is at Johannesburg.
Krugersdorp Prison, 2 years ago, typically characterized by problems inherited from the prison's legacy of the past regime. Today, through the progressive vision of new management and involvement of the community, Krugersdorp Prison has become a model example of correctional services in the true sense of the word.
There was a lot of violence, problems between members and prisoners. Prisoners doing nothing daily, and we decided to do something about it. The Creation Committee suggested that we should invite the community to get them involved in this prison. And we arranged a champagne breakfast, and we took them into the prison, showed them what we needed to give more facilities for the prisoners. They donated a computer, a fully equipped gym, a fun room with snooker tables, paint, so that we can use certain paintings on the walls. While we were busy bringing all the changes in, we also noticed that there were less assaults on prisoners by the members because they were less frustrated. And I also noticed that the prisoners' self-esteem changed a lot because they were proud of what they were doing. We started slowly just doing the gym, then the fun room, then the soccer clubs. Afterwards, the glass and lead work and woodwork. Every time we did any changes, we did notify all the members. Why do we do it? Because in the first instance, they didn't understand it. They didn't approve it because we didn't do it in the past like that. In the past, we concentrated more on keeping somebody locked up. We didn't change the person inside the prison. He went out better than he came in. My personal opinion is that you can't rehabilitate a prisoner. He can only rehabilitate himself. But I think it's our responsibility to give him the facilities, training, learning certain skills, try to motivate him, try to change his attitude and his self-esteem. If we can change that and he accept it, then you can say that prisoner will rehabilitate. The community usually wants us to punish him twice. But I think if you lock up a prisoner, you should also punish him inside. I think it's a wrong perception, because the fact that his freedom is taken away, it's punished enough. At 4:30, we start lockup. Then it's still a prison again. Then you're locked up in a cell, and you really feel like being in a prison. We want to run our prison properly. To do that, we must know of anything that's wrong in our prison. So we decided to put about 16 telephones in this prison. It helped us a lot because now the prisoners got the opportunity to phone lawyers, human rights, SARP, or any prison. They also phoned me personally. I've noticed over the 2 years here what changes happened in this prison. Our prisoners that was very aggressive swear that members changed their lives. I also noticed how the family got involved, trying to help the prisoners. The gangs aren't any more active. So I think we're on the right track. We're going to send back a better prison than what we receive. And I believe that they will live a better life outside.
In South Africa, of 126,000 prisoners, some 2,900 are women. Most are mothers, and at Johannesburg Prison, there are currently 31 babies living in prison.
I'm the investigation officer of the female section. What I do is when people escape from prison, or when they assault each other, or with this, you know, when they smuggle, anything that you can think of, I investigate. At the moment, Dacha is actually the biggest problem here inside. The total is about 605 at the moment. But the most common crimes is theft, and then robbery is second, and then at the end is the murder cases. There's tension, there's stress, the prisoners get upset, you know. They fight the members, they scream at the members, and now actually when they do it at the members do it back.
I'm here for murder and robbery. My boyfriend shot and killed a man, stole his car. I didn't know the man was dead. He threatened to kill me if I say anything. I was with him. Then we got caught, and then I came here very pregnant and very beaten up by my boyfriend. I couldn't walk, nothing. And then I was put into the hospital section. And I had a very difficult pregnancy. Shantae threatened to, you know, to be born early and everything. So I was taken very good care of by correctional services. They were excellent with me. I got this good sister down there, Sister Leafy. She's like a mother. She used to come to my bed. She put me on strict bed rest. And then I went into early labor again, 23 days too early. And Shantae was born. She was born with a little gap in her heart, but they take good care of her, yeah. It's very disciplined. You have to wake up 5 o'clock in the mornings. By first gate, it's round about 6:30. You have to be dressed, baby dressed, bathed, everything. It's very hard because sometimes your baby gets sick at night, and you know the members can't be here 24 hours a day just watching through your window whether your baby's going to be sick or not, and you have to call for help. And then eventually, when they hear you, they come immediately, and then they get the medic out from the men's side, and he comes and checks out your baby. If he's not happy, he sends you out to Garden City Clinic. I miss my family, my children. I've got a daughter of 10 and a boy of 5, living in Saldanha Bay with my parents. If I get sentenced, which I pray to God I don't, Shantae will stay with me until she's 2 years old, then she has to go. She'll join her brother and sister in Saldanha Bay.
The prisoners see you as someone to come with problems, especially about when they've got children at home, and you know, you must support them, look after them, and always be there for them.
We are no more,
we are no more,
we are no more strangers.
I was convicted on buying stolen car parts. Let me rather say, I'm in a motor industry. Some of the parts in my scrapyards were stolen. They were from chopped cars of some kind. Well, I was sentenced 4 years, 3 months. I wouldn't really say one is sent to prison to be punished. It's a matter of analyzing yourself. Get yourself together, know where you went wrong, and take the possibilities of whatever will be offered to you, like courses, to change yourself in a way. You can study, you can further your education. I never knew how to sew before. Even if my dress would just run a bit, I would take it to the menders. Well, I had a privilege of working in the workshop on my first arrival, where I was taught a straight machine. I made this curtain myself, yes. Now I can sew. I have 2 certificates on flower arranging, and I have a certificate on knitting. I learned so many things in prison. The first one is to tolerate different characters, because here we are from all walks of life. Sometimes I may be troublesome myself, and I may not be aware through stress. Maybe I phoned home and someone told me of something wrong. Maybe a member passing or just another sister passing, I lose my head or so. So that's what actually happens. You may not be aware of that, that maybe you are troublesome as a person. First, I have forgiven myself. That is important. And my family has accepted me as much as I wrong the community. Obviously, they will watch, but what is important is to prove yourself to the community and do not have self-pity in life.
number to change it from the police. He bumps it. But it's just a parrot.
I'm here for 8 years for a fraud. I was very naive. I mean, for me having to put checks into my own transmission account, firstly that were not made out in my name, tells you. I mean, you know, I knew I'd have to be caught sometime. My company was very, very disappointed because they held a lot of trust in me. And I've got to make it up to my husband and to his family and to my own family, my children, my grandchildren. They're the ones that suffer the most. When I was actually passed a sentence of 8 years, I was devastated. I couldn't come to terms with 8 years. It's a long time. It really is a long time. I thought, you know, along the terms of perhaps house arrest, community service, not prison, definitely not. And it's very difficult. If you don't keep yourself busy all day and you don't have your loved ones outside there giving you support, I doubt very much if you're going to make it. Being away from your family, it's the worst thing. I miss my husband Dave very, very much. Him going through what he went through after me being arrested, to come to terms with that, being here and only seeing him in half an hour once a week. And of course, I miss my daughters very much. I really do, my grandchildren. You hear the different kinds of crimes that have been committed and so forth. And you've always got to be alert. I mean, after all, it is prison. You know, especially as I say, if you're a woman that has, you've got your dignity and you know that you're a lady and you know that you could never come to terms with hardened crimes and things like it, but yet you are all together. And it's a fearful thing.
It's really got me into a brush cutting.
Yeah. I've still got about 4 years to serve. I feel very heartsore about it. I think if you've been in here for 6 months, 10 months, you really have rehabilitated. You know that by the time you go out there, you will never think of doing fraud. Not in a million years. I'm quite prepared to go and stay in a caravan and have whatever I have to have, as long as I know it's my own material things, but not go out there to live with the Joneses. It's not worth it. Mentally and psychologically, definitely not.
With lockup at around 3:30 in the afternoon, after an endless process of counting and recounting, prisoners are locked away, and a new shift of members comes on duty. Under the old regime, prisons were run along military lines. With transformation, this system has been replaced by a progressive, democratic approach, reliant on management skills in the place of authority exercised by rank. Of high priority has also been a program of affirmative action to ensure a 70-30 ratio in favor of so-termed underrepresented population groups by April next year.
Here's the transition. We've got to accept it. We cannot be in a new dispensation with old policies. But the communication in our department, I'm sorry to say that it's very poor. People are guessing. Rumors are flying around. I think we are about 24 senior management members at Johannesburg. And from the 24, 18 will be removed. It's unthinkable that a place like Johannesburg, with the complex problems that you are, that a manager can take over with no one to advise him, no one to guide him, no training has taken place. There should have been the buddy system as what they initially intended to be. But it appears now that that's not going to happen.
That's good. I wanted to clean it up. because that management corrupted Johannesburg. That's why Johannesburg cannot be controlled. That's why there's smuggling. That's why there are guns. That's why prisoners are vanishing in the system, because those managers have failed. And we want new managers who will control the situation. The issue of training is immaterial. Some of these guys that are with us here have worked 20 years in prison. Whatever training they need is management training. And management training you can get as you develop on the job. And we don't need apartheid training. We don't need apartheid experience. We need progressive experience. Because the past experience, as I say, is embodied with people who still want rights. And they can contaminate people who want to be progressive to work with us. So the sooner they are in place, and the sooner they fumble and fall and come up, the better will be the system. And it will be built on a stronger foundation of people who made mistakes and came up.
I think the taking away of the ranks went along with taking away discipline. That was not the intention, but at the end of the day, everything went down the drain. Before, we had discipline parades and also had discussions with your members on what you would like them to do, how to do it, and so on. At present moment, that system is not in place.
There are people who come to work telling themselves that no one will tell me what to do. Maybe sometimes the guy the previous day was drunk and then he's papalazed anyhow. You don't feel like doing anything, we'll just sit and bask on the sun or rather listen to the radio.
The discipline were caused by many factors. People who rejected the new progressive way and people who still wanted ranks to manage the prison and never thought that the management skills are the only thing that can manage prisons. We had negative people who couldn't accept black management. I can assure you that the curve will go up as possible. By October, we'll be having sober waters. In terms of more space, you know, in the Western Cape, two prisons have been commissioned. Two of them are getting complete in July. And that will help, especially Portsmouth, with its overpopulation. And the minister has commissioned seven more prisons. That we hope to occupy next year, sometimes in October. And we have commissioned three more, the one in Bavianspoort, they've started building, Empangeni Richards Bay, as well as Pietermaritzburg, as a means of dealing with overcrowding. And we are fighting with the Public Service Commission. We are trying to put sense into them, to let them understand our circumstances, why we need more personnel. Our vision is that by the year 2000, we should achieve what we want in terms of seeing to it that we offer the community the service that they demand.
I'm in this department, and I don't feel safe myself. We see the statistics of the escapes, the hostage dramas and things that have taken place now in Albans Prison. The people that we've got at Johannesburg, quite a number of them are ex-death row prisoners. Many of our prisoners are serving sentences up to 75 years and even longer. These people have got nothing to lose. Any attempt to threaten other people's lives, these people are going to any length to escape.
It's not acceptable to have such a high rate of escape, and therefore we are not trying to be defensive. You deal with people of whom about 60% can be rehabilitated, can be better citizens, can come back and reintegrate into society. But you have to be aware that we've got 40% people who will never repent if you see the type of crimes that they are committing. Well, I've mentioned it before that we should look at hard options. And, you know, when one mentioned the fact that we can use a mineshaft, there was high outrage because people felt it's impossible, it won't happen. And people forget that there are people who work 14 hours underneath digging gold for this country's economy. But we continue investigating that. If it comes to that, we'll take them there. But if there are other alternatives, we'll look into alternatives and see what can we do to see to it that, you know, we lock these people in a situation where they won't be a problem to other prisoners, because I can assure you they kill other prisoners and they rape other prisoners. They do all sorts of things that are out of order.
Okay. Under 21 years of age, there are over 10,500 sentenced juveniles, serving terms of up to 20 years.
Ik is Jonathan Kluta. Ik is 20 jaar oud. Ik heb bij woeste gevangenis beantracht van haar hoofd. En ik doe net 3 jaar gevangenisstraf. En vandaag is hij met die moeite weer komen naar plek zoals die te wisten. Ik kom hier liever als je vandaag naar plek zoals die niet.
Ik dien na 7 jaar uit gevangenisstraf. Ik is hier voor 2 moorden. Een poging tot moord. Waarvan ik vandaag spijt is. Hoe kan men zeggen, hier een plek zoals die. Alle moeten maar gedraaid buiten. Maar nu komen een plek zoals die. Als die moeite weer.
In line with the broader national debate on youth in conflict with the law, it is now policy to provide separate detention facilities for sentenced juveniles. With the youth lies the country's hopes for the future. Brunflay, providing for the development and rehabilitation of some 300 sentenced juveniles, is one of 10 youth correctional centers, providing a comprehensive daily school program. This development program includes languages, mathematics, agriculture, skills training and a variety of sports, with the backup of spiritual, social and psychological services. The objective is to rehabilitate and develop the juvenile to his full potential, equipping him with the means to reintegrate into society.
And it's a song called, "You're Making Me High." So if you think the team is making you high, think again, because this is Brunflay Youth Center's own basic radio.
You know, never in the history of the department has there been such drastic attention on the youth, because the 7 prisons that are commissioned, about 4 of them are for the juveniles. And we're trying as much as possible to give attention to them. If you look at our project, our pilot program in Newcastle, trying to see what impact can we have on the youth in trying to change them. And that pilot program will be followed by another in Baviaanspoort, by another in Eastern Cape. And if there are positive results, we'll do as much as possible and see to it that we can save the youth.
Transponder cards and fingerprint readers facilitate electronic monitoring of access and movement in the flexible environment of the Ekuseni Youth Development Center, which is run along the lines of a learning institution for some 600 students. Potential students are screened and assessed, and to qualify for Ekuseni, they must be willing to commit themselves to a learning program where they can study a variety of subjects, from literacy to matric, industrial and technical courses.
Me, I'm from Johannesburg, so I was attempted car theft. Yes, we have a gun. I have 6 more years to be here. And that is why I'm here in Ekuseni, because I want to develop my life. And when I leave this place, Ekuseni, maybe I can be something better outside in life.
As you can see, this is a learning institution whereby we're trying to prove there are people who can change from their evil doings and integrated to the society. In fact, just like me, I came here to Ekuseni because I was willing to change. I've seen the mistakes that I've done before, and I decided to come here so that I'll improve my life. For me, I know that as I'm here, I've lost almost everything that I had, and even the people that I like to be with, and I miss them all. So what I could say to them is, they mustn't waste their time running around committing crime. They must just go to school, because education is the key to everything.
With 1 month left to serve, the final countdown begins as Gregory Boyson reflects on 16 years behind bars.
The worst time for me was not seeing my daughter and not hearing of my mother, not a single word. And last month she sent me a letter after 16 years.
Homeless, moonlight sleeping on the midnight lake. Homeless, homeless.
I can look people in their eyes, and I can allow them to look into my eyes. I can keep quiet when people argue with me or reasons with me or even shout at me. I can just accept it. I can think of the future because I know and I think I still have a future.
Somebody sing!
Hello, hello, hello!
I don't have to lie anymore.
Somebody sing!
I don't want to lie anymore. I don't want to live a crooked life, an unrighteous life anymore. I want to live straight. I don't want to come to prison anymore. No more coming back to prison, and I'm not afraid to go out there because I know I'm going to stay out there.
Somebody cry.
Why, why,
why? Ayo chabula wasithandayo kulumana.